بالله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه والاه. So إن شاء الله we continue دار الآخرة حلقة. So our حلقة tonight is very short إن شاء الله. And we have been talking about different things related to death and the next life and what we should do and حسن الخاتمة وسوء الخاتمة, a good ending of someone's life and a bad ending of someone's life. So today's episode inshallah will be very short and brief, but it will be very beneficial inshallah, hopefully. There was a student, his name was Hatim al-Asam. You probably heard the name before. He was very very knowledgeable. And his teacher was Shaqiq al-Balkhi. So this is his teacher, al-Balkhi. So the teacher said one day to his student, Hatim, Ya Hatim, you have been following me for 30 years now. What did you learn from me? Like Hatim would sit with Shaqiq and learn different things from him in fiqh and tafsir and Quran and Arabic and different things. And Hatim would go to other shuyukh as well and learn from him. So, فقال شقيق البلخي لحاتم يعني صاحبتني 30 سنة فماذا أفدت مني. You have been sitting with me, learning from me for 30 years now. What did you learn from me in the last three decades? 30 years. فقال حاتم أفدت منك ثمانية مسائل. I learned only 8 things. So I said, لا حول ولا قوة. I wasted my life with you 30 years teaching you different things, and now you said you learned only 8 things from me. What is this? فقال والله إني لا أكذب. I'm telling you the truth. The most important things that I learned from you are 8 things. And I think if someone يعني, understood these 8 things and tries to apply them to his life or her life, inshallah their life will be successful and these 8 tips will be very beneficial to them. فقال وما هي؟ قال أما الأولى فنظرت فوجدت أن لكل إنسان محبوب أمره يحبه. في اللي بيحب الفلوس المصاري, في اللي بيحب أولاده, في اللي بيحب زوجته زوجه وكذا, ويحب أشياء مختلفة. فإذا مات الإنسان وانتهى أجله أو أجله فهذه الأمور تفارقه ولا تدخل معه إلى قبره. فأردت أن أخذ محبوبي معي إلى القبر فما وجدت إلا عملي, العمل الصالح فقط هو اللي يدخل معي. So he said, what are these 8 things that you learned from me and you think are very beneficial? He said, number one, when I looked around and I see everyone loving something different. So some people, they love money. Some people, they love their positions or their thrones. Some people love food. Some people love their children. Some people love their partner or their wife or husband. So, but he said, I noticed something. When someone dies and they go to the grave, they don't take any of these things with them to the grave. Yani no one takes their food with them. No one takes their wife with them. No one takes their kids with them to the grave. None of that goes to the grave. Except one thing. I realized that the only good thing that I love that I can actually take with me to the grave is my good deeds. This is the only thing that I will take with me to the grave, and this is the only thing that would benefit me in Akhirah, so I focused on this. I know in the ancient Egyptian times and in some other cultures, they take their food and their money and everything with them because they believed in the next life and they think that this will benefit them in the next life. But this is a totally different concept. Tamar, I think I told you the story before of the man who made a deal with his wife. They worked together, they had a business, and the husband and wife, they were working all the time, hard-working people, and they made close to $1 million. So the husband said, okay, we will make a deal. Whoever dies first, the second one, the remaining one, will take half of the money, 500,000, and he will put 500,000 in the grave for the other one. So the wife said, okay, no problem, I swear, khalas, just die, no problem. So sure enough, the husband died first because technically women live more than men. The life expectancy for women is higher than men. You know what we do, like heart attacks, blood pressure, we die. Alhamdulillah, the sisters live longer. This is the fact. So the sister said, okay, I want to give him the money and I want to keep my promise, but the thing is, what he's gonna do with the money anyway in Akhirah? There's no ATM machine in Akhirah. You're not going to use the money to buy anything, right? If he goes to Jannah, everything is free. If he goes to Jahannam, he can't do anything with the money, right? So I want to keep all the money for myself, but in the meantime, I want to keep my word to my husband. So what she did, basically, she wrote him a check for $500,000, and she put the check in the grave, and she kept all the money for herself. She kept her word, she gave him half, alhamdulillah, everyone is happy, right? That's good. Sisters are very smart, mashallah. So this is the first one. He said that the only thing will come with me to the grave is my good deeds. So I loved my good deeds, and inshallah I'm going to take with them to the grave. And he said the second thing, يعني رأيت أن الناس يتبعون أهواءهم. He said, I noticed that people always follow their desires, and they worship their desires. And this is mentioned in the Quran. فرأيت من اتخذ إلهه هواء. Have you seen those who take their desires as gods? Whatever their desires tell them, خلاص, they follow their desires. If their desires tell them, well, drugs are halal, خلاص, this is what I'll do. Riba is halal, خلاص, I'll do that. Zabiha khanzir is okay, no problem, I'll do that. There's no such thing as zabiha khanzir. But if someone follows their desire, خلاص, they will do everything to satisfy the desire. And I mentioned before that when you... We were in Edmonton, and there was a brother, he had a store, and he was selling, you know, pork, and he was selling beer and stuff, and we spoke with him one time, and he said, okay, I'm selling it to non-Muslims, it should be halal. And I told him, in Islam, if something is haram, it doesn't matter if you're selling it to a Muslim or a non-Muslim, it doesn't really matter. If it's haram, it's haram. Like, say, for example, zina with a Muslim woman is haram, but you're telling me zina with a non-Muslim woman is halal. It doesn't make sense. What is haram is always haram, regardless if it is done with a Muslim or a non-Muslim. So he said, well, because I'm selling it to a non-Muslim, then the money is halal. And I said, the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى إِذَا حَرَّمَ شَيْئًا حَرَّمَ أَكْلَ ثَمَنِهِ. The Prophet ﷺ says, if Allah made something haram, then the income, the money coming out of that money is also haram. Right? So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made pork haram, then if you sell it, the money coming out of it is also haram. Same thing. I'm not sure if there is any Somali here tonight. But the Somalis have a very wonderful expression they use in this regard. They say basically, Bakhtiga ma'unu lakin maqi san'abba, which basically means, I don't eat dead meat, I just drink the soup of dead meat. It's the same thing. So if pork is haram, then the money coming out of pork or alcohol is also haram. It's the same thing. So people follow their desires and they love their desires. So when I came across this ayah in the Quran, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَفْسَ النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. And those who are afraid of standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for judgment, and they stop themselves from following their desires, then the final end, the ultimate reward is Jannah. So now I know that I should not follow my desires, I should follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this short life, and eventually I'll go to Jannah, which is the eternal life. You say, Urdu zindagi bahut mukhtasari. Life is very short. Even if you live 200 years, this is a short period of time compared to the life in Akhirah. Number three, he said, I see people fighting all the time over money, over jobs, over this, over that. Then when I looked in the Quran and I see this statement from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reassuring us, مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ. He said, I see people fighting over money, houses, cars, this, that. Even subhanAllah, brothers and sisters, they fight and they kill each other over inheritance, a piece of land. I heard stories about guys killing their mother or their father to buy something, and their parents were not willing to give them the money, so they killed their parents. And in some cases, a person will kill another person to inherit from them. And you know the story of the cow of Bani Israel in Surah Baqarah, it's the same thing. So people kill each other over money, over this dunya. Then he said, when I saw this ayah in the Quran, مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدُ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَقٍ, he said, I saw this ayah, it says, whatever you have will come to an end. It will not stay forever. But whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for you, this is eternal. Like the reward in Jannah and Akhirah, this is the best for you. We fight over a small thing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the real thing, He has the real reward. And subhanAllah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about dunya and akhirah and He makes a comparison, He says, وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ. The life of akhirah is the true life. What does that mean? It means that this life is basically like a cartoon movie, it's fake. And you read in Surah Fajr, يَوْمَئِذٍ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ وَأَنَّ لَهُ الذِّكْرَ يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي قَدَّمْتُ لِحَيَاتِي. The person will bite their fingers in regret, in remorse, and they say, I wish I had done something for my true life. If this is the true life, what about this one? Again, it's a cartoon movie. It's not a real life. This is just like a test. But the life in Akhirah is the true life. So he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that whatever you have will come to an end, but whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for you is everlasting. So he said, I focused on an Akhirah and I dedicated my life to the service of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hoping to get the reward. He said, number four, people take pride, يعني الناس يبحثون عن العزة في الأموال وفي الأقوام إلى آخره ويفتخرون بذلك. فحتى ويسفكون دماء بعضهم البعض طلبا للعزة والشهرة والمكانة وكذا. فلما قرأت قوله تعالى في سورة الحجرات إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم فاخترت التقوى فأرجو الله تعالى أن أكون عنده كريما. So he said, people always fight with each other to find izzah, dignity, in wealth, in positions, in status, in society, in families, and so on and so forth. And they fight and they compete with one another. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us the secret, the key to izzah in the Quran. He said, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honorable, dignified, noble in the sight of Allah is the one who has taqwa among you. So it is taqwa that counts, not gold, not anything else. So he said, I focused on taqwa and I hope that Allah will make me honorable on the Day of Judgment. أما الخامسة يعني رأيت الناس يذم بعضهم بعضا ويغتاب بعضهم بعضا ويحسد بعضهم بعضا فوجدت السبب في ذلك السعة في الرزق والضيق في الرزق. He said, when I looked at people and I see them envious and jealous of one another, they always look at each other, he has this big car, he has this big house, this, and they are jealous of one another. And I realized that the reason is one thing, and Allah mentioned it in the Quran. He said, نحن قسمنا بينهم معيشتهم في الحياة الدنيا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm the one who distributed the arzaq between the people, so now there is no jealousy in my heart, because I know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave some more than others. So it is, the distribution is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not from the people. So they are the recipients of the rizq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I know that rizq is from Him, and He is the one who did the distribution. So I am not envious or jealous of anyone. أَمَّا السَّادِسَةُ فَرَأَيْتُ النَّاسَ يُعَادِي بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا. Everyone in this world has friends or enemies. And they have a lot of enemies, right? So people fight with each other because, for example, they have businesses and you don't want someone to steal your business or make more money than you or take your customers. People are always fighting. Why? I read in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Shaitan is your real enemy, so take him as your enemy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that shaitan is your enemy, not the people. So focus your enmity on shaitan. So he said, فَصَلَّطُ عَدَاوَتِي عَلَى الشَّيْطَانِ وَتَرَكْتُ الْإِنسَانِ فَاسْتَرَاحَتْ نَفْسِ. He said, now I don't have enemies from among people. I focus all my enmity toward shaitan, so I put my heart at ease. I don't hate any human being. Maybe I disagree with their actions, but I hate shaitan, I don't hate people. Maybe I disagree or I hate their actions, but I don't hate the people themselves. I direct my adawa, my enmity towards shaitan. أما السابعة فرأيت الناس يطلبون القوت والمعاش من حلال ومن حرام إلى آخره فلما قرأت قوله تعالى وما من دابة في الأرض إلا على الله رزقها فعلمت أن رزقي لا يأخذه غيري فاستراحت نفسي. He said, when I look around And I see people trying to make a living by halal and haram. As we mentioned in the khutbah today, people يعني, obtain the rizq from halal and from haram. And I looked at the Quran and I see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. There is not a single living being in this world, whether we're talking about humans or birds or fish, anything, except that the rizq is guaranteed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have to do anything haram. Your rizq is coming your way regardless. All you have to do is do your job, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the rizq. So this is what you need to do. So he said, once I know that my rizq is coming from Allah and no one will take my rizq, I put my heart at ease. Maybe you're familiar with the story of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. I think I mentioned the story in one of the khutbahs. And I use the hadith as an explanation for another hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam في ترغيب والترهيب للمنذرين. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما من أمر يقربكم إلى الجنة إلا وقد أمرتكم به وما من أمر يقربكم من النار إلا وقد نهيتكم عنه وإن روح القدس يعني جبريل عليه السلام قد نفث في روعي أنه لن تموت نفس قبل أن تستوفي رزقها وأجلها فاتقوا الله وأجملوا في الطلب فإنما عند الله لا ينال بمعصيته. It's a beautiful hadith. If you can, frame it and keep it in your house. So the Prophet ﷺ says in this authentic hadith, تَرْغِيبُ وَالتَّرَهِيبُ لِلْمُنْذَرِينَ, he said, there is nothing that brings you closer to Jannah except that I told you to do. And there is nothing that brings you closer to Jahannam except I told you to avoid. And Jibreel alayhi salam inspired me that no one will die without taking their full risk before they leave this world. They will live the span of life that Allah has written for them, and they will also take their whole risk before they leave this world. No one is taking your risk. So the Prophet ﷺ said, be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and take your risk from halal, not from haram, because your risk is coming to your way anyway. But sometimes we become impatient and we take it in a haram way. So now the story of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, the story says that he was traveling one day with his servant and they had a horse. And on the back of the horse, Ali Sirj, and Hassan kan alayhi Sirj. So the horse had a very elaborate, a very beautiful saddle on the back of the horse, very beautiful. So it seems like they missed Salatul Dhuhr, Salatul Asr, and they wanted to go inside a masjid or something on the way to pray. So there was a man lingering outside the masjid, sitting outside the masjid, doing nothing. I call them zombies, people who sit outside doing nothing, right? So Ali radiallahu anhu said, okay, will you please keep an eye on the horse until we pray namaz and come back? And he said, no problem, just go and pray, no problem. So Ali radiallahu anhu went inside with his servant, they prayed their namaz, their salah, and on the way out, Ali radiallahu anhu was saying, well, I think we should give this man $10 for his time, for keeping an eye on our horse for 10 minutes. The servant said, well, it sounds like a good idea. They went outside, the horse was there, but the saddle on the back of the horse was gone. It seems that the man who was sitting outside was a chor, a thief. So what happened? He took the saddle from the back of the horse and ran away. Mushkila kabira. So Ali radiallahu anhu, la hawla la quwwata illa billah, and he sent his servant to the market, he gave him the $10, and he said, buy a saddle for us, ishtari lana sirjan. So sure enough, the servant went to the market, and he found the chor, the thief, you call him tug in Somalia, he found the thief standing in the market, and selling the saddle for $10. $10. So Allah sent him the $10 in halal way, but he was impatient, and he took the money in haram way. Thamina, the last one, قال إني رأيت الناس كل واحد يتوكل على شيء فمن الناس من يتوكل على منصبه وليتوكل على أمواله وليتوكل على نسبه وشرفه وكذا وعلمت أن كل ذلك يفوت فتوكلت على الحي الذي لا يموت. He said, I see people putting their trust, mashallah, they are proud of something they have, and they put their trust either in their money, their family, their social status, their chair, mashallah. So they are proud of these things, and they put their trusts in this because they think they will live a good life because of this. But I realized that all of these things will go away. The money, the good health, the family status, everything will go away. So I put my trust in someone that never dies. So I put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the eternal. He never dies. فَقَالَ شَقِيقٌ وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ جَمَعْتَ الْعِلْمَ كُلَّهُ His teacher said, by Allah, you contain what you said, all the 10 cases that you mentioned, they contain or encompass all the big knowledge of this world. If someone has this knowledge and they keep this mind and they act upon these 8 things, they will be happy in this dunya and they will be honorable in the akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the best in this life and give us the best in the life to come. And give us sincerity in everything we say and do. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. جزاك الله خيرا. السلام عليكم.